So thank you very much for the introduction. So I'm happy to be here to present our work. This continuous variable entropy concern relation in the presence of quantum memory. This is joint work together with Mario Berta, Volker Scholz, and Matthias Cristandl from the ETH Zurich, and Marco Thoma Michel, CQT in Singapore. He's also still here, maybe in the audience. So let me just briefly give some small history. I mean, we already heard in the previous talk a lot about it. So it started actually, and I'm focused here on continuous variables, so I'm more like emphasizing the position and momentum operators. So it starts like with the Heisenberg's uncertainty relation, where we have a bound on the product of the variance of position and momentum operators. Then it was already generalized to differential for Neumann entropies by Bechner, Bielanicki, Birula, and Michiasecki. This is two independent works here. And there they got a constant which is log e pi. So this actually improves this one because it's general, so these variants are not so good measure of entropies. So, and then maybe now maybe state the most prominent one in the finite dimensional version. I mean, this is the one by Maas and Ufink. There we have two observables, S and T, and for now we just assume that they are rank one observables. And then we can have the bound is given by this constant, and this constant is independent, as we saw in the last talk, from the state. So we actually get for any state a bound, and this is important. And it's just the overlap of the measurements. You can generalize it to arbitrary POVMs, and so on. But what's important actually for cryptography, of course, is that we actually include in an adversary. So we have to always be a little kind of more paranoid. So we have to actually just characterizing the uncertainty of an observable is not enough in the normal case. So we want to actually characterize it, conditioned on some side information, on some adversary which has some entanglement with your system. So that's why we actually want to introduce some additional system. So this is how these quantum memories. And the situation is the following. So we still have kind of here, this is I call Alice side. Alice always doing the measurement. And the measurement also called S and T in this picture here. And then we have actually a tripartite situation where we have Alice, Bob, and Charlie. They get a quantum state, they share. And then Alice does this measurement. And what we want to quantify is actually the outcome, the uncertainty, the outcome distribution of this observable here, given this quantum memory, and the one of the observable T, given the quantum memory of Charlie. And maybe I give first the intuition why this actually should be somehow possible. And this is just a simple example. So we assume now that actually Alice and Bob just sharing maximally entangled qubits. And then Alice is just doing either a measurement in the computation basis or the diagonal basis, and then we consider the situation. And what we find out, of course, is that because Alice is actually maximally entangled with Bob, Eve is completely uncorrelated. And the other fact is also, this also affects, of course, because they're maximally entangled, that for Charlie, the system looks completely random. So if you conclude this, then because the uncertainty for Bob is, of course, there is no uncertainty because they're maximally entangled. But for Charlie, we have complete kind of uncertainty because the state is maximally mixed and she's completely uncorrelated. So this is actually a really nice combination of this uncertainty principle with monogamy of entanglement. So, and you can do this precise, of course, using conditional entropies. So here, this is for the von Neumann entropy, it's shown in this paper here. And this is like the von Neumann entropy, this conditional von Neumann entropy of the outcome of the distribution S given the quantum memory B. I mean, you can, in this simple case, if this is all finite dimensional, you can just write it in the following way here. But it's not so important. I've just think about the uncertainty of this outcome given the side information. So we have this bound, and here this constant is the same as in the previous one, in the bound from Maas and Ufink. And this is exactly what you're usually using in quantum key distribution. And that's why we got so interested in these relations. So if you just draw the picture a little different, we have here actually Alice Lab. She's doing some measurements. Then we assume for now she has the source. She sends some particle to Bob, and maybe there's a side channel Eve. But this is exactly this tripartite situation we saw before. And now we can just apply our uncertainty relation to give kind of a bound on at least one of the outcomes here given Eve's information. And one can then use some other tricks and actually get bounds on the average of these two outcomes. So this can actually directly be applied to QKD protocols. This has been done successfully in these two works. I mean, maybe there's others which I miss. This was the first one I'm aware of. So this one, a discrete protocol. This is security of a BB84 protocol against coherent attacks and finite size effects. The good thing with these uncertainty relations is that you can include finite size effects, and you also can have just, it's actually good to show security directly against coherent attacks. You don't need any, quantum definite inference. And this has also been done for a continuous variable protocol where one uses two mode squeeze states, and also this was one of the first proof against coherent attacks, including finite size effects, which we actually, got positive key rates. And in this case, actually, for later reference, we use, one uses actually a finite number of outcomes of the measurements. And what we're going to see is now a continuous number of outcomes. And this has also been implemented. There was a talk on Monday by Tobias Eberle. So our contribution, let me just summarize it quickly, that we have actually this generalized, this uncertainty principle to arbitrary continuous outcomes. We allow for arbitrary quantum memory, so this means that we have infinite dimensional systems, so this most general case. And we actually consider two kind of entropies in our work. This is the condition for Neumann entropy, which actually gives in the information theoretic sense the asymptotic limit, as we saw before. But we also, of course, for cryptography, we're interested in the one-shot case in the finite size, where we can have these finite size effects. And there, it's the relevant entropy is this conditional mean entropy. So we also showed it for min and max entropies. These are the relevant for the finite size QKD. Maybe let me point out two recent other works which are related. So there was by Frank and Lieb. There was just recently a paper where they showed a similar, uncertainty relation for differential conditions for Neumann entropies, but they use actually a different and more restrictive definition of this entropy. And then there was another paper where one shows also, for finite number of outcomes for the arbitrary quantum memory, the uncertainty relation for min and max entropies. So in the following, I only show the results because it's easier. It's maybe you're more familiar with this for Neumann entropies. I only show the result for Neumann entropy. Good, this is my brief outlook here. I first just focus, talk a little bit about continuous variable system, then I show how we define this differential condition for Neumann entropy, and kind of one of our main results is kind of this approximation, which is finer coarse graining. I will explain what this is, and then I show our uncertainty relations. So, but maybe the best example in quantum information processing for a continuous variable system is if one measures quadratures of an electromagnetic field. In that case, one uses homodyne detection. Homodyne detection is just we have our signal, which we want to measure. Then we overlap it here on a 50-50 beam splitter with a local oscillator. And then we have here these photodiodes, and then the photocurrent, and we subtract this here. And by kind of adjusting the relative phase of these two incoming signals, we can actually measure different direction in the phase space. If we choose, one usually uses then a simplified model that we have only one mode here we consider on, and then the Hilbert phase is actually just given by the same as if you look at the harmonic oscillator, so it's an infinite dimensional Hilbert space. And these measurements we're doing here can be quite precisely modeled by actually position momentum operator. So if you have actually two measurements and they have a relative phase shift of p over 2, then this operator satisfy this canonical commutation relation. So they're position and momentum operators. And what we know there is that they have actually a continuous spectrum. So, but there's of course different way how we can actually measure this or kind of treat these measurements. there's actually what I usually call in the continuous outcome case, where we really think we have this theoretical device. This theoretical device is actually producing actually a continuous outcome. Of course, everyone knows this is not really practical. We always have this issue that we can just measure it in certain precision. But we can think of this ideal device in this model I presented here. And of course, we have to, since we are interested, I mean, with these outcomes relative to a quantum memory, we have to actually allow that they may be correlated at the beginning or entangled here with this other system, Bob. So the outcome of such an event is kind of, we have here such an outcome here, which can be any value on the real line. And conditioned on this outcome, we have a post-measurement state here, which is then the state of this quantum memory after I read out this map. And in the following, we just abbreviate this situation by this rho xb. This just means we have a continuous probability distribution and a continuous set of outcome states. But what can I also think about? Okay, what we're actually doing maybe in a lab is that we have some, our measurement has some kind of certain resolution, so it's a finite precision. In the following, all this delta is always characterized the precision of our measurement devices. So this here, and then what we have actually, we kind of, or our model, of course it's maybe a little simplified, but we always then assume that we just divide our real line in intervals of a length delta. So we have just this spinning, and this is just kind of fixed. But what is the outcome here is now discrete. So this is now, if I have a continuous variable x, and I look at the discretization with some length here delta, then I'm just usually referred as x delta in the following. And then we have actually the same. We have for each outcome here, we have a post-measurement state. So I hope now the setting is clear. So now we want to actually consider the entropies of these two situations. And maybe, let me just say, it's clear that if you have this continuous outcome, we can actually always kind of deduce this discrete outcomes here. And that's why we can usually talk about the coarse graining of our continuous, space. So our approach to this differential conditional entropy was that we want to have kind of a unified definition holding for any possible variable, for discrete outcomes, for continuous outcomes. And what we want is that if you have such a situation I explained before and we let this delta go to zero, that we actually retrieve actually the entropy given for this continuous variable. It's quite an operational approach, and I think then we also have a better intuition what this entropy really says, these differential ones. Further, what we wanted to do is kind of a most general setting that we don't have any restriction. We don't want to have a restriction on states, on which states the entropies are defined, and all these things, because I think this is really important for QKD, that we have the most general setting and make no assumptions. Here I have just a quick slide how we defined these entropies for the case for Neumann entropy. So maybe just short introduction about conditional entropy. So if that for the beginning assume that this Y here is just finite and discrete. And then we have a finite dimensional Hilbert space here on the B system. So how we usually define conditional entropy is just we take in here, we subtract the one of H of the system YB, the entropy, minus the system B. And here, this is just the normal for Neumann entropy of the two systems. But you can also write it a little differently, which is actually really useful for our situation. So we can write it in terms of this quantum relative entropy, which you can write in this way. And one big reason is because we're looking at infinite dimensional systems, so there are a lot of technicalities arise in this. If you deal with infinite dimensions, also concerning entropies, but this was actually solved or entirely solved by Araki defined it, and Petz and so on, they actually discussed this entropy for arbitrary kind of infinite dimensional systems. So we actually knew a lot about this entropy of infinite dimensions. And then it's actually straightforward. Just take this definition, and then we have this general definition where we just integrate over this X system. And in the following, this is here a measure space, but we don't care. In the following, the only thing we care is that if X is the real line, as discussed before, then we can just integrate it, and we call it a differential entropy, and in the following with a lower, lowercase letter here. And the uppercase letter is the discrete case where we just have this sum here. This is just actually the same like here, but now we have infinite sums. Okay. So now let's just get to the situation, back to the situation where we have a continuous variable. We have two measurements, one with a finite precision delta and one with the infinite precision. And sorry about this delta here. There's no delta here. This is the entropy of just the continuous variable. And then we actually look at these two entropies and we want to kind of show that they converge. Of course, we have to regularize them because, of course, if we let this delta go to infinity, this just diverges because, I'm just making the alphabet bigger and bigger. And as we see later, this just scales actually like log of this or minus log of this delta here. So we have to regularize this, but if we regularize it, we get it actually that we can approximate them. So we get this approximation theorem that we can just take this discrete entropies, regularize it with the volume. Of course, you can do this in arbitrary volumes also as well, but now I'm fixed on the real line. But if you regularize it with the volume, then you actually get this limit behavior. Good, and we have here some small assumption, but on the usual physical situation, like finite energy, they're always satisfied. Maybe just briefly give some, I talked already before that this is one of our main goals, that we have actually this statement here that we can think of this differential one as arising from this limit here. I think it's quite an operational approach. And it's also really, really helpful for practical computation because this quantity is usually really hard to compute for small deltas, but these are usually easier to compute, especially if one considers Gaussian states and so on. So we can approximate them. It's more practical-ish. And here's just a short argument. If you look, if you have a continuous function, we make this delta arbitrary small. At one point, almost every function looks constant. Of course, there are some nasty function, but we don't consider it here. But then this looks constant with respect to these intervals here. And then you can see that it actually scales like this log over delta. So we always have this behavior. So we can say that it converges if the delta is small enough. Actually, that the function looks constant over these discretizations. Good. Let me now go to the uncertainty relation. So first, we look at the situation where we have a finite precision. So this is indicated by this delta here. So this is our quality of our measurement device. And now this can be arbitrary infinite dimensional system. And we now look at the situation where we have a position measurement here and a momentum measurement. And then the uncertainty relation is given by the following. So we have this here, the entropy is on this side, and the bound is given by this constant here. And this constant is actually, you can compute it as the overlap of the measurements. It's entirely the same as in the finite dimensional case. So you just, if you look at normal POVMs, so the constant is actually computed like this. And this Q delta K this, and this P delta L, they're just kind of the projectors onto these intervals of length delta. And if you look, you can express them in terms of functions, but if you want to approximate it for small delta, they really behave like delta square root 2 pi. So maybe let me show you some graph. If you look at this C delta here, then you see that, this is support of the vacuum, so almost all vacuum is around here. So then we see, of course, then the uncertainty has to vanish because we actually can prepare with, states. We have no uncertainty with respect to this resolution of our device. But you also see that if we go, here this is the minus log of C delta. This is the real constant which appears in the uncertainty relation. If we go below the variance of the vacuum, it actually increases quite fast. So from this, we can actually easily achieve the continuous version by just using the approximation I showed before. We just take this approximation for delta to zero. We know that this entropy is converged. We just can compute the constant here. And then what we find is just this, that we have this log over log 2 pi here. And here, one interesting question is if this is actually a tight, this relation, or sharp. So, and with sharp, I mean if there exists a state such that equality holds. And I mean, some other entropies are already, for the mass and Ufink, if you generalize it to side information, you see that it's already tied with outside information because you know that mass and Ufink are tied for a certain constellation of measurements. But this wasn't the case in our situation, so we know this better bound here, proven before, that this is actually already, tight, and it's tied for just Gaussian, pure Gaussian state, for a pure Gaussian state. So we knew actually we have to think a little more to get actually include our side information to actually see if it's tight, and this was really a nice result that we actually saw that it's still tight now with side information. So what happened, the states for which we actually achieved this, it's not tight that we can, that there exists a state that it's equality, but we can get arbitrarily close. So and this gap closes exponentially here. So this is, this is kind of the game. And the states for which we actually achieve this equality is actually the EPR state for infinite squeezing. So maybe I have to explain a little more. We consider A and B, the quantum memory, and A and B, they're actually the same system. It's just two modes. That's a two-mode system. And then on this, we can actually just take two modes, and then we assume they're in a vacuum state, and then we squeeze these vacuum states, and then we overlap it on a 50-50 beam splitter. What we get out here is kind of this two-mode squeeze state or these EPR states. And now if this squeezing is infinite and we overlap it, then we get this state. And this is actually the state also appearing in the EPR paper by Einstein, Podolsky, Rosen. And what they have is that they have maximally correlation if both actually measure the same quadrature. So if both measure the position or the momentum, they're maximally correlated. So this is the axis of Alice measurement and this is Bob measurement. And this is the distribution, of course, now for a finite squeezing. If the squeezing goes infinity, this is a delta function, we have we have just perfect correlation. And in this case, in this situation, if we take the limit to this situation, we close this gap. And as you see here, it's actually exponential in the squeezing. And maybe who is not actually familiar, and I didn't tell what this squeezing are, but this line here corresponds to a squeezing of 10 dB, which actually can be achieved in a lab nowadays. So this was just a recent report of such a source. So we actually can produce state for which actually equality almost holds. Good. Let me quickly summarize. So I just presented you some general differential condition entropy measure. We derived some uncertainty relation for position momentum operators, and we showed that they're actually for the continuous case they're tight for the differential condition for Neumann entropy. So maybe I emphasize again that we also show same for min and max entropies. They're tight for finite and also in infinite precision measurements. So for delta, bigger than zero, and also for delta to zero. But these are then other states, and it's already tied with outside information. So it's not, we don't have this behavior like for the von Neumann entropy. And we hope, of course, that there is possible application in quantum key distribution protocols with continuous variables, because so far the proof, I mentioned before the paper, they use some kind of this spinning, and maybe one can actually simplify it by using these continuous outcomes. And also kind of it can be easy actually what we showed that this is always true, so we have a bound on these entropies, which also makes it maybe easier to work with this. And of course we're hoping that there are more application in the future of our uncertainty relation. And with this, thank you very much for your attention.